Well, welcome. We're here to see a screening of Catching the Sun, directed by Shalini Katiya. The way the evening is going to go is we're going to have a panel discussion that will run for a half an hour or so. Then we'll watch the movie that runs, I think, an hour and 15 minutes. And then after that, there'll be a Q&A. There'll be some cards passed around that you can put questions on that will come up to us. And in between all that, before and after the movie, there'll be intermissions. Okay, so that's the way things should go if they go as planned. We have... to my mind, a very good panel tonight. I'm going to go alphabetically. The first member of the panel is to my immediate right, Joe Desmond. And he's worked in both the private and public energy sectors for 3 decades. He's currently Senior Vice President of Marketing and Government Affairs for Bright Source Energy, where he oversees communications, marketing, and government and regulatory affairs. Prior to joining Bright Source Energy, he served as an executive vice president and chief marketing and business development officer at Ice Energy and senior vice president of external affairs at Northern Star Natural Gas. In the public sector, he held several positions under California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, including deputy secretary of energy for the state Resources Agency, Chairman of the California Energy Commission, and Undersecretary for Energy Affairs, and that was probably a lot of fun.
It was a lot of fun.
And now we have Agnan Miljanic. Close enough. He is an associate professor of chemistry here at the University of Houston. He is an innovative teacher and researcher. He was named a Cottrell Scholar in 2013, an honor awarded by the Research Corporation for Science Advancement that goes to early career science educators in the physical sciences and related fields. He is the first University of Houston faculty member to receive that recognition, and of the 13 recipients that year, he was the only scholar from a University of Texas to receive the award. Over the last several years, thankfully, he's been teaching the Introduction to Energy and Sustainability, one of the 2 courses currently required for the Energy and Sustainability minor. Next, we have Chris Ross, and he currently serves as Executive Professor of Finance at the Barrow School of Business, where he shares his insights from a long consulting career in the international oil and gas industry. He began his career in 1966 with British Petroleum in London, where he reported to the board on issues of nationalization in the Middle East and Africa. 1973, he joined Arthur D. Little, moved to Algeria, where he assisted Sonatrach, the national oil company, with challenges in oil and LNG and advising on OPEC issues such as price coordination, price indexation, and production quotas. In 1978, he moved with ADL from there to Cambridge, and then later on came here to Houston, where he opened the Houston office in 1982. And he did consulting from then until 2010. His consulting work has covered the entire length of the value chain in oil and gas, upstream, midstream, and downstream. In the 1980s and 90s, he worked with Venezuela's PDVSA, the national oil company, and YPF of Argentina on a number of high-level strategic issues related to the 2 countries' oil and gas sectors. In the 2000s, he has turned his attention to North America and the oil and gas industry here, including portfolio strategy for independence and for companies with midstream and upstream interest and assets, and the value potential of the downstream sector for major oil companies. Finally, we have Kristen Winterstein. She's an assistant professor in history. She teaches a broad range of things: environmental history, Latin American history, global history, food studies, public history. Her research centers on the ocean and the maritime world, especially when it comes to environmental history. She explores the history of history and the ecology of fisheries, industrialization, and the impacts of this process at a global scale, especially as it relates to food systems. Geographically, she's focused on the Pacific coast of the Americas, Chile, Peru, the United States, their coastal waters, and more recently, the Gulf of Mexico. So that's our panel. Thank you. I want to start by asking the panel a question that I was going to ask at the end, but a panelist suggested I ask it at the beginning, so I'll go backwards and work the other way. What do you all think the audience should watch or look for or think about when they watch this film? Who wants to start?
Yeah.
Chris, go ahead.
See whether that make this work. Do I have to press something?
Okay, that's better. First thing is, I'd like to test the audience here for a moment. Would you all agree that we're better off if energy is affordable, reliable, and clean? Everybody agree to that? Right? Okay. Would you accept that occasionally there are trade-offs between those three attributes? Yeah? Okay, that's all right, then I can get on with it. Phew. Glad we got over that one. I'll get into a bit more detail later, but I don't want to hog the microphone. I'd like you, when you're going through the program, to listen very carefully to what they say about the affordability of energy, and the plans that they're doing, the reliability of that energy, and the plans they have for bringing it out, and obviously the clean. Now, there's no real quarrel on that solar is clean. So those are the three things I want you to keep in your, I'd like you to keep in mind: affordability, reliability, and clean. And how the movie sort of deals with those issues.
Fair enough.
Yeah. Sure. There's a few things, and I promise I will give you at least one Schwarzenegger story connected to Texas before the night is out.
That's cool.
I could start with that, but I'll come back to it. You know, the movie, a lot of this footage takes place in 2007-2009 time frame. And it's important to remember, as you listen to the statements that they're making, renewable energy, and in this case photovoltaics, was very expensive at the time. Just keep in mind that costs have come down significantly. I mean, I think panels are being installed today at the rate of 1 per minute across the United States. 2 years ago, it was about 4 per minute. So it's just amazing, the penetration. So there's been a lot of change. Keep that in mind when you think about what they'll be making statements about vision. And in fact, a lot of what they probably have, I haven't seen this, just giving you the context, has come to pass in terms of cost reduction, the recognition of climate change concerns, likewise the benefits to the economy associated with investments in clean energy. So I think it'll be interesting to watch and then kind of look back and see what's new, what's different, and how things have changed.
Hi everyone. As the historian in the group, I would encourage you to think about the people who are being featured in this story and what do those people represent, or what do their stories represent as they tell us about them in the way the film is constructed, and also for the same matter, who is left out, who are we not hearing from in this film, and how do those things shape the way that you are understanding the message of the film? So we would think of this as a document that's constructed with a particular message to tell, and it might be an ambiguous message, or it might be a message that is resonates differently with different people. So you can think about that in the sense of making sense of where to put more weight when you hear different kinds of information in relation to topics like this. Similarly, you can think about cinematographic techniques such as music or framing and the ways that those things are employed to, like I said, tell a story. So since as historians we focus on the texts and how they're constructed,
sure.
That would be my advice going into it.
Very good.
All right, and so the movie is about solar energy, and that is obvious from the title, and it will become quickly apparent. What I would like to perhaps focus on is the less obvious things that the movie talks about, such as the job training program, which is a form of vocational training, as well as things such as difference in regulatory environments in China, Germany, and the US that the movie will touch upon, issues of investing both in the US and abroad. And then I would also reiterate the point that that the movie was produced in 2015. It was released in 2015, but a lot of events that take place in the movie date from a couple of years before that. And so the things have changed since, some in favor of solar energy, as mentioned before, and some such as the oil price has changed in a favor that in the direction now that oil is more competitive than it used to be in 2009. So, thank you.
Good. Maybe the next question is for Professor Blanche. Since he's you know, as I said, he's a chemist, and so what might you tell the audience about the science?
So the movie mentions, it's for my taste a little qualitative, but most things are very qualitative for my taste. But the movie mentions a couple of key statistics, one of which is that all humanity's annual needs for energy could be satisfied if we could just fully capture an hour and a half of sunlight. So sun is such a powerful energy source that in just an hour and a half, it gives us all the energy that the humanity consumes in a year. And this is now the reasons why we can't capture all of the sunlight are both fundamental and practical. The most important reason is that most of it falls in the middle of Pacific Ocean. In some locations, this capture is completely impractical. But there are technological limitations that are associated even with the current technologies available for capture. So most of the solar technologies we have now have capture efficiency on the order of between 10 and 20%. And this is, this might seem like a low number, but it's actually better than photosynthesis, which is nature's way of capturing solar light. And so a lot of changes in the competitiveness of solar relative to other energy sources will come both from development in technology and from lowering the price of technology, but also from the development of economies of scale. So that, and I think most significant, at least in my view, the most significant lowering of cost came from economic perspective, not as of today, from really developing cheaper scientific technologies.
Okay. Anybody have any comments? Okay. So we're here to talk about solar energy, and I guess the next place to go to think about are what are the positives, right? Why do we think this is a good idea or a good thing? And there's a whole host of them. I mean, there's what's the first one we might think about?
Aesthetically, it just seems a very good answer. If I mean, It just sits, photovoltaic anyway, just sits there and converts light into electricity and with no moving parts and no emissions. So yeah. you can't you it, it's it, if we can do it so that it's affordable and reliable, then I think it wins.
Yeah, but then we're in business. Because there's no greenhouse gases, and it's clean. And it's
well, open. It depends where the I mean, it depends how you make the things. I don't know.
I suppose,
quite,
yeah.
I don't. You know, that we saw, I think, a very sanitized view of a Chinese factory, but but yes, in principle. Joe, you've got to have
it. Yeah, I could go on. It's easier for me to talk about the challenges. I'm so used to having to deal with those types of problems.
Yeah.
But the obvious one is it's clean. It is a renewable resource, and it's addressing many of the things people want. But you can go beyond that. People really love solar, and particularly many people, primarily advocates, strong advocates. There's a lot of appeal to the notion of being able to go off the grid. Now,
yes.
That's an unusual concept. I say unusual because people who really want to break away from the regulated monopoly, the regulated utility, say, I want to go off the grid, and we can talk about that at length, about what's required to actually pull that off. But you go around the globe, and the challenge here is it's a global challenge of one bringing electrification and clean water to people around the world. Solar is a distributed resource that allows us to get to places you otherwise can't get, and as those costs continue to come down. So there's the job creation aspect, there is clearly the localization, but it presents its own sets of challenges. And I want to come back to something we talked about. You mentioned, Chris, reliability, and yet you also talked about some of the impacts of these technologies.
Yeah.
When you have too much of one resource on the grid, you create unanticipated consequences, and they deal with what it takes to keep the lights on. And so you're seeing a change and an evolution, at least at the regulatory level, as people think about not so much what's the capital cost per watt, or what is the cost of levelized cost of energy if I produce a kilowatt hour, but really a systems perspective of what does it take to keep the lights on.
Yeah.
There's a role for solar, and certainly solar PV is the dominant resource there. There are other types of solar. But you require other solutions. There's a need for geographic diversity, resource diversity. There are many, many factors that are involved here. So when I think about solar, there are many, many positives and clearly far outweigh the negatives. But by and large, it hits on all three things, reliability.
Yeah, when you talk about going off the grid, I mean, the first thing that I thought about was, you know, isolated and rural areas that power can't get to otherwise.
Absolutely. I mean, one of the things is whether solar can be cost competitive, and that depends on what the alternative is. And if you're in many parts of Africa or islands around the Pacific or like that, there is no alternative.
Yeah.
So the you're looking at solar compared to nothing, no electricity, and it seems to me that the sooner we can move solar into those sorts of areas, the better. Solar has a much tougher time competing with natural gas in the U.S. On the economics and on the reliability.
Did that turn you off?
Yeah. So that this is, I would add to the challenges the question of intermittency, that so the sun doesn't shine all the time, and that this is really not a problem with solar. It's a problem with the grid systems. That utilities will need to offset this with some other energy source that will, you know, make up the difference when the sun doesn't shine. This is not necessarily a challenge or a pro or a con, but solar is a very dispersed and it's not a localized source, which means that we save a lot of energy losses from distribution, because if a person has solar panels on their roof, then this is that there's no transmission here needed. But at the same time presents a challenge in how do you power a really large concentrated consumer? How do you power places like aluminum factories or Manhattan or some place where there's not so much land area, but there's a lot of consumption? I would also add that in places like places that don't have access to electricity, there is a huge difference between zero electricity and a little bit of electricity. And then a little bit and there's a much smaller difference between a little bit of electricity and a lot of electricity, because just a little bit of electricity can keep a fridge on running and preserving medicines and provide lights, provide cell phone access, which is now enabling connectivity.
I just wanted to also come back to a point that was raised earlier about the diversity, because that's something that I was thinking about a lot as well. This is sort of, I suppose it falls under the pros of solar energy. Sure. And other types of energy that are not just solar. I was looking at some maps. They're available online. If you search on Google, you can see maps of where all of the drilling sites are in Texas and the rest of the country. And you'll see that on the Texas coast and Louisiana as well, it's very heavily concentrated, as you will not be surprised, with oil and gas drilling. And then on the other hand, there are some clusters of solar that are up towards the west and the northern parts of Texas. So that was interesting. I don't know if you're able to comment more on that at some other time in the conversation. I thought that was interesting to know about the geography of that in our state. And then on the other hand, comparing it with California, which is the site where our documentary is set, you can see a relatively greater variety of diversity of energy sources and the way that they're spread out geographically around the state, as well as the types. So these are maps that are color-coded by the type of extraction. So easy to find on Google.
What about something that we'll see in the movie in terms of a positive, in terms of, and Joey, you may have something to say about this, about jobs and where solar may, you know, have some job growth and whatnot?
Sure. The issue of jobs, again, I go back to the financial crisis of 2007 when we were coming out of it, and much of the focus of the government really was on identifying shovel-ready, as they call them, shovel-ready projects where we could put people back to work. I can recall on one of our projects in California, at the time, the unemployment roll, the union unemployment roll was as high as 32% in San Bernardino County. People were struggling just to get by and to put food on the table. What's interesting is that there's a bunch of other issues that crop up around a focus on jobs. It turns out that the emphasis on green jobs, one, was hard to peg down because fundamentally these jobs are the same jobs that you have in building energy, any energy infrastructure. And it was interesting because at the time the criticism leveled was, surprisingly, on sort of the right side, these are temporary jobs. We shouldn't invest in these. And they would look at a project, and the project would be $2 billion. I'll use ours as an example. A $2 billion project that at its peak employed 3,000 people and brought returning Afghanistan and Iraqi war veterans and trained them. All that, it literally emptied the benches, I want to say, in the unemployment office by bringing them back to work.
Sure.
But the argument was, well, these are just temporary jobs. And the fact is, if you're in construction, you're always putting yourself out of a job. And you have to be very careful and think through when people are leveling criticisms. You know, energy policy makes for strange bedfellows at times. I can tell you and can give numerous examples on, you know, a particular species advocate. Will say something that is picked up by somebody in the coal industry who repeats it. And here you are in the middle saying, well, wait a second, I thought siting and permitting renewable energy projects was going to be easy. People would welcome us with open arms, when in fact it is just as hard as permitting any infrastructure project. All the same issues that crop up with that. So that time frame, 2007, you had investment tax credit that was put into place. You had no tax equity available to speak of, meaning companies weren't profitable, which means that there's no profits to offset with these tax incentives. So they created alternative mechanisms, very efficient. Did some great things at the time. Yeah. And loan guarantees. How do we bring innovative technology to scale? And a lot of what went on in that period, people to be commended for, that we would not be here today with these low prices had it not been for a combination of all those. But I'll wrap up by simply saying, when you think about energy and these projects, you're really talking about, behind the scenes, the policies that deal with land use, that deal with climate, yeah, that deal with energy, environmental, and species protection. And they all kind of bundle together in a way that makes for some very interesting and challenging times, but also, as I said, rewarding times.
Okay. One of the things I thought about, I mean, this is a pretty straightforward positive, is, and I don't know whether, I mean, I don't know, whether solar, I think it does, solar power avoids the sort of, I guess, politics and price volatility, okay, that is problematic to the hydrocarbon industry. And so is that a positive?
Well, the movie starts with an explosion at the Richmond refinery, which is, I would say, you might want to think about quite what the relevance of that is to solar power. But that's an interesting. And then later on in the movie, there's some a marvelous sort of caricature of the right-wing pundits, which I never watched that program, but if they really are as bad as that. They are. it's pretty shocking, and then they have a very a photogenic and quiet spoken and delightful representative of the solar industry, that Van Jens, who you know, he's a charming gentleman, and it's interesting. I'm not sure they could have found someone who was perhaps less. Telegenic for the solar, and they certainly could have found someone who was more than the Fox News people.
What do you all think about? If you're out talking about this, right? Like, I mean, one of the questions I was going to ask is like, what brought us here? I mean, apart from being invited, right? Why is this worth talking about? And one of the tensions is what goes on with solar power and the fact that it's clean, at a certain decisive level it's free, and how it compares to other energy sources, whether it's hydrocarbons or coal, and you know sort of like if you're an advocate for solar power, and we may or may not be. Right, depending, you know, but you know, sort of like, what's the elevator speech, or what brought us here, and why is this worth talking about?
It's important to talk about, because at the end of the day, we need elected officials and decision makers to be making informed decisions, not decisions based on headlines, not decisions based on what sounds good today, but informed decisions. And the energy system really is about trade-offs. It's about creating the appropriate balance between reliability, affordability, and environmental responsibility. When you go too far in one direction, there's a feedback effect. China is the classic example of that feedback effect. But I say it's important to be informed, even as consumers, because you have choice. There's a lot of changes. If I were to describe the grid of the future, it is going to be characterized by two-way power flow, two-way information flow, and a combination of centralized and decentralized power. It's not going to be all distributed. It's not going to shift suddenly back to centralized, but it is evolving, and we need to have the regulations keep up with that. There are many issues, and we can talk about them in more detail afterwards, but introduced by the rapid adoption of PV, you get into the regulatory compact, stranded assets, about how do I ensure the financial stability of the system when people are leaving the grid? What about the cost shifting issues that occur the interesting mental exercises you can do comparing it to other industries, net energy metering policies. They're certainly generous, but suddenly they're not sustainable. How are you going to change tariffs? There's a whole host of issues that are connected with this shift to clean energy, distributed energy, and greater intelligence on the grid. So I hope we'll have a chance to get into that in a lot more detail.
Sure. Actually, that's my pet peeve, in fact, that the economics of renewables is not very transparent because of mandates. Which you don't see the cost of the mandate. It just happens. The need for supersizing the transmission to cope with surges in power, and of course the issue. I was on a panel one time, and a solar guy was asked, "So, well, what's the biggest technical problem you face?" He scratched his head a bit and said, "Night." So there's the issue of storage, and how much that costs, and I find it quite difficult to unravel, and I've spent some time doing it, so I'd like to see that a little bit more transparent. Yeah.
Kristen, what do you think this is worth hanging out and talking about?
Well, yes, going back to your question, what brought us here, and you know. The way that I would answer this is that I think that as, well, myself as a professor, but as a citizen, we all have a responsibility to try to understand what our energy landscape looks like today and how it came to be that way. And this is one part of the larger story. One documentary will give you some insights into certain elements of it, and it's just part of a larger, you know, fabric of information that we have to construct for ourselves. And so there's certainly a lot at stake for everyone in this room and for our city as a petrochemical producing center of the entire country. There are also lots of battles going on every day in the news over these things, including the major standoff in North Dakota that's taking place right now. An explosion that occurred in the ship channel yesterday here. So I think we should always be thinking about what are the environmental costs and benefits, and what are some of the ways of distributing those so that we can lessen the risk towards humans, like people who live in cities.
Well, to me, the thing that sort of brought me here and sort of the interest that I have is that to me, the way I see a movie is that it talks about three countries, although it's very focused on the U.S., but also talks about China quite a bit, and to a relatively small extent about Germany as well. And so I think it's, and all these three countries are increasing the abundance of solar in the overall energy makeup. It's just they're choosing very different pathways to get there. And to me, it's not clear which one of them is the best, and it might be that it's not clear to anybody. And so sort of seeing what shapes these pathways, such as, you know, regulatory environment and, you know, political agendas in Germany and China, the fact that the global warming as a man-made phenomenon is just accepted and it's sort of rolled into the regulation already. In the U.S., there's still a debate about that. And so sort of seeing how these three countries shape their pathways towards what it will almost certainly be an increase in solar penetration in the market is sort of what interests me the most.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna shift the conversation a bit to negatives. Okay. What are the shortcomings in terms of technology, cost, efficiency? What's the downside?
Well, I think one thing that the movie doesn't mention is that solar energy relies heavily on the production of semiconductors. And this is, you know, chemical industry. And chemical industry is not known as being terribly clean industry, right? So production of semiconductors is simply a dirty industry and uses a lot of energy and deals with some toxic materials. And of course, there's regulation that governs all that. But some estimates say that most solar panels spend the first year to 2 years of their productive life making up the dirty energy that was used in their production. And so this is, you know, in a big picture of things, this is not a big problem because most solar panels would last for 20 to 30 years. So they will more than make up for that. But this is one point that this is, on the front end, not entirely a clean industry. The other issue that is that of cost. The cost has been coming down a lot, but admittedly from a pretty high starting point. And then the last one is that that there's sort of challenges associated with this dispersion of power that offers opportunities as well as challenges.
Yeah,
in terms of powering really big concentrated consumers. And this is where the place of these solar cities that will be mentioned in the film, that's where they come in.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know a whole lot about it, but I mean, what about this question of, I guess, a way you might put a solar intensity? I mean, the fact that there's a lot of sun in some places and not so much sun in others, and, you know,
It, that's not a negative in the sense it simply impacts the attractiveness of the economics of a given project. It'll change. Just think of it like a sliding scale. The more sun, the higher the production. It's hard to find a lot of negatives, and I don't mean to say that as I'm here as a big solar proponent. It is one of many renewable energy solutions that people are working towards. I think it's unfortunate, considering the amount of energy and dollars that the U.S. invested, that China was the primary beneficiary of that PV revolution in the production, based in large part to many of the financial policies that support and encourage that. That's unfortunate. However, the U.S. has continued and does continue to invest in advanced technology, perovskites. There's also, I'm not the chemist. Perovskites. Thank you. I'm not the chemist, but nonetheless, the issues presented by heavy levels of penetration of variable resources require thinking about how to complement. That introduces the notion of storage. There are opportunities to electrify the transportation sector to build off peak load. There are scheduling and coordination opportunities by looking at distributing more resources across a broader geographic area to take advantage of the diversity, temporal diversity and spatial diversity. But like any project, any project comes with impacts. Utility scale solar, whether it's solar thermal or PV, is like building any infrastructure project. It has impacts. You need to think about how to minimize them. It requires transmission. You can, in fact, do all those things. But at the utility scale, the cost, it's less than 4 cents a kilowatt hour at the wholesale level. And in fact, approaching 3 in places like Chile. It's very, very inexpensive. Rooftop can be 3 to 4 times more expensive, which raises this question about cost shifting. If a utility can get it in a competitive bid situation at 5 cents a kilowatt hour, let's say in Texas, why would you want to be paying necessarily a residential customer who's generating excess 4 times that much? These are questions you have to wrestle with. So as I said, it's not so much it's a drawback of the technology, but it introduces a new set of challenges that you have to work through.
Yeah, yeah, Chris.
It's also regressive that which is unfortunate, because the people who are putting in people who are putting solar panels are generally not the poorest people, but the people who are paying everybody pays the feed-in tariff. So it's a little bit worrisome when it's too generous.
In California, though, I tell you, the economics justified, and I'll be clear, I'm not originally from California. If you couldn't tell, I have a Boston accent. If you stick around long enough, you'll hear it. And I even had an office here in Houston for a number of years when I worked for Northern Star Natural Gas. So, but my kids are from California, so I guess I'm part California now. Nonetheless, where was I going to say about this? No, I'm just kidding. I know. The rates in California, through distortions of public policy and rules adopted, designed to sort of inadvertently create winners and losers among different rate classes. At one point, PG&E's marginal tariff, in which the burden went to large users, people with big homes and air conditioning or pool, it was 49 cents a kilowatt hour. So you can see why the economics made sense. The cost shifting, it required redoing the rates, but now you're looking at having to rethink the delivery of energy. A PV panel on a house doesn't provide necessarily the kVAR, the energy required from inductive motor loads. So how you price and how you value these things becomes more and more important, and you want to get it right. You want a framework that incents consumption, investment. These are all questions about markets versus incentives versus mandates, and it's the eternal argument in battle between free market and folks who'd rather regulate everything. Yeah, but
Kristen, do you think about negatives or shortcomings?
Negatives and shortcomings of solar energy?
Yeah.
Well, I haven't investigated it thoroughly in terms if I were going to install it, for example, on my house, but I know that is a major factor,
the
cost that has been mentioned. So these things, it matters for an individual who's interacting with the market at a different, let's say, well, cost and scale from corporations who negotiate whole separate rates for their energy consumption and other types of things.
Okay.
So the question of scale, you know, is it more effective to have a large corporation implementing it versus trying to get residential areas to install more solar panels and try to give back to the grid in this way? Yeah, I have more questions than answers, I feel.
Yeah, sure. It may well be the case for most of us. This question originally was directed, Joe, about business, mm-hmm. the business end of it.
Yeah.
But I want to expand it to the other three panelists and ask about the business end of it and to talk about, you know, what solar energy might look like in 5 years or 10 years or 20 years or whatever. And the reason I thought about this is several years ago I was on a panel with a guy named Gal Luft. He's a very bright guy, and he was talking about electric cars. And he said, now, look, you know, if you want to go buy an electric car and that suits you, you know, God bless you, right? But you're not going to save, you know, the ecosystem of the world by having an electric car. But he said, this is what you might do. You'll buy an electric car, and then there'll be some more money to develop technology and so forth and so on. And he used the analogy of the first portable phones that were about the size of a small brick, right? And he said, but then there were the first few, and then they got better, and then they got better, and now we have smartphones that everyone has that do everything but wash your car, right? And that's what I think about as I was thinking about solar energy, is like, you know, what's the business end look like? What's the future look like, okay? And how, as consumers or citizens, ought we to think about the importance of solar moving forward?
You want?
Sure, whatever. Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's a mouthful, I guess.
Sure.
Obviously, yeah. You know, if your phone battery dies, you know, you're okay, but if the power goes out and you're there without power for a week, it's a life existential issue. So there are differences between electricity and the role that electricity plays in society and the economy than, say, consumer goods.
Sure.
I think we'd all acknowledge that. I think you'd be surprised. We should continue to expect, like Moore's Law, continued efficiency gains in the underlying technology and performance of the modules themselves. Mm-hmm. Today, though, the largest component cost, the largest cost category of PV, distributed rooftop PV, are the soft costs. Permitting, installation, customer acquisition, that's really a challenge. It's also why you see the performance, the financial performance of companies like SolarCity under pressure, because the cost of customer acquisition is very high. It just, if you were to think about other businesses that don't scale well, electrical contracting doesn't scale well on a national basis. Very few national companies, unless you're an EPC, engineering, mm-hmm. procurement, construction contractor. So it suggests then that things become more standardized, access becomes easier, that there's some innovation to be had in the soft side of things. Additionally, there's innovation in the financing of these projects on the residential and commercial side. We've gone from being able to do third-party leases in exchange for the power to power purchase agreements to now loans and something called PACE financing, which is property assessed clean energy. And that is where it's a voluntary assessment, tax assessment on your property that carries with the property. That has the benefit of aligning the benefits that you get from the investment in, whether it's efficiency or solar, with the duration of life of those products. So you're going to see more innovation there. You continue to see innovation. I'm surprised. There are a lot of innovation hubs around the country where they host 40 different solar companies looking at everything from how do I do better analysis. Yesterday I saw how do I rotate the panels on a roof. There's different business models of community-owned solar that allow people who cannot put solar on the roof or perhaps they can't justify that cost for whatever reason, mm-hmm. to where you can take an ownership interest, like an equity ownership interest in a solar farm that is managed by a third party. So I think you'll continue to see innovations there. Where the innovation needs to come, and it will come the slowest, which is the most important, is in the regulations, in the recognition of what's the value of reliability, what's the value of capacity, what are the appropriate price signals, because those are always being weighed against the goals of how do I ensure ease of understanding, fairness, maintaining the financial integrity of the utility. They all have to be balanced. You just can't abandon that, otherwise someone has to foot that bill. So lots of innovation to come. Storage is a big part, but storage is not going to work at the distribution level unless the incentives in the tariffs are lined up.
Okay. One other thing you haven't mentioned yet, which I agree with everything you said. The other one is how do you reward people for building backup power? There are various ways that are being looked at, auctions and various other ways. But the network that Joe is talking about, which I think is what we probably think is the ultimate solution, will require backup power. I don't think it can all be done with batteries for a while.
So what I would add to this is sort of that I see the future of solar and related technologies that there will be a lot more integration there is currently. So the way a residential consumer would approach solar now, that they would have a house that was built in the 70s, and then utilities came and put in a meter. And then 30 years later, they're retrofitting their roof to put solar on. And while all that is happening, their car is this independently powered system that they park in front of the house every day. Mm-hmm. And in the future, and not too distant future, I think that a lot of solar will not be done as retrofitting anymore. It will be part of new construction, which would then allow people to roll it into their mortgage or whatever way they're financing the rest of their house. It would also lower a lot of costs because you wouldn't need to build some things twice. And then that together coupled with a smart grid, which is sort of an information exchange system between a consumer and a utility, and the car, which would be electric and serve as a large battery, so as a storage unit for electricity, and would not no longer be independently powered from the house, would present this integrated system which would both be easier to control, which would minimize some of the losses and solve some, but not all of the storage problems, and which would be cheaper.
So it's the question about the future of
solar?
Yeah,
just, I mean...
Okay. All right, well, historians don't tend to dabble in future predictions, but I would just, again, turn attention towards some questions, because one thing that we do think a lot about is uncertainty and how are businesses and how are individuals handling the question of uncertainty and what is our energy future? Certainly, businesses and individuals and other entities in our society have to make plans and predictions in order to function 1 or 2 or 5 or 10 years out. So we don't really know exactly, you know, what types of technological advances might suddenly facilitate making superconductors somehow more easily or cleanly, for example. And the other big question for me is if this is going to be something that spreads, let's say more generally, that people tend to see more solar panels around and it's more accessible technology, I still would wonder who will be using this technology because they tend to be introduced to the market at a higher rate than what is accessible to the majority of people, which also relates then to the question of sort of overall cultural reception and the way that the cultures overall might be thinking about green technologies. And I'm saying this in part to set up some of the discussion that you'll see in the film when we start it in a few minutes. So.
Okay. Yeah, I think we've hit our time, as they say.
I'll save the story for afterwards.
Yeah. Okay, so there's a short intermission. Then we're going to see the movie. Then there'll be another intermission, and then we'll come back for Q&A, and he's going to tell a Schwarzenegger story. We'll see y'all in a bit. Thank you.
This is a question, I think for Joe, but it also, well, first part is, Harris County is number one county in the United States for CO2 emissions. Number two is Los Angeles. How can the University of Houston promote solar for the clean air benefit? Joe?
Sure, I think it's a great question. Texas has already been very successful in promoting renewable energy policy, particularly with respect to wind. The only way you can, if you want to tie it solely to clean air, you got to monetize that. In California, there air quality management districts issue certain types of permits that have to comply. But they've made a strong effort, the Lung Association, the other associations, a very strong effort to correlate asthma and environmental conditions with criteria pollutants, not CO2 emissions, but criteria pollutants made worse by, let's say, formation of some of the weather patterns that they have. But it's CARB is coming under the California Air Resource Board now, who has that responsibility under the cap and trade bill. I want to say today, I believe, Governor Brown signed into law the SB 32, which is the extension of the cap and trade bill, coupled with a target of a 40% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions to 1990 levels by 2030. But there's also some legislative oversight. There needs to be an incentive and a recognition that there's multiple benefits to the solar. I don't want to overlook, and this is one of the things that came out, I was reminded of watching the movie, the local benefits and the multiplier effect that occurs in the local economy when those dollars are invested there and when they're deployed there, whether that's efficiency or solar or the job creation. There were some interesting points. But it really is a concerted effort to say, you're looking to diversify resources, you want to help transition. I think people would agree there is an environmental issue under the current conditions, and you need to take steps to try and mitigate against that.
Joe, if I can jump in as part of that question,
yep.
Those are macro issues. I think the question was specifically, what could the University of Houston and this ecosystem do in order to change the equation?
Sorry, you're right. That was the question, and I misread that. There's a lot that the university can do. I'll give you some examples that I'm aware of in other universities, cross-disciplinary programs that they have established just in terms of defining new graduate degrees and undergraduate degrees that deal not just in sustainability, but combine some others. They have also implemented campus-wide programs on solar and efficiency retrofits as a way of teaching both students and giving them jobs, but really raising awareness of what those economic benefits are. I would think promoting the results of what those benefits would be within the community and across the alumni about what was accomplished, what was saved, both in terms of dollars and avoided emissions. Mm-hmm. There's all sorts of sort of gaming activities that you could do. I don't mean as in gambling, but the gamification of incenting people to look at where these opportunities lie. You could do a demonstration center and compare. I mean, there's I would imagine a number of initiatives that you could draw upon where other universities have to really get people focused on what the benefits of solar would be.
Thank you.
I guess one of the things in seeing this, I'd like to have some comments on. Seems to me the sheer amount of win-lose thinking in our political economic narrative, China wins, U.S. is going to lose, or if Germany wins, U.S. is going to lose, or vice versa. And they only very lately in the movie talked about, you actually have low-cost panels that actually would help the U.S., and so we got in this big trade war with China over solar panels that basically drove up the cost of solar panels. So, I mean, I just kind of want to have you all, maybe comment on that.
Yeah, I noticed that as well. There was, the whole treatment of costs was also sort of largely absent. There were several remarks during the movie that say, look, free power. And yeah, it's free once you've done all the installation, but and then you've got the problem of night again. So I think there, and everything had to be solved by supportive policies, not by the basic economics, and that was what was really troubling me. These people were constantly sort of saying we have to have the policy framework, and every time I heard that, what I heard was subsidies or mandates or some other way to distort the playing field. Why not put a carbon tax on? That seems to me, and then it would be they'd get credit. Everybody would get credit for not producing carbon dioxide. Incidentally, I really don't like considering carbon dioxide as a pollutant. It's a plant food as far as I'm concerned. but I do think that they're asking for special treatment all the time, rather than setting up an economic framework where people would do naturally the things that make the most sense.
I can comment a little further on that. There's a lot of issues that you raise, and you're right. I would agree that the cost issue was somewhat glossed over. You know, once it's installed, I get free power. Well, there's a capital cost that comes with that. But I think historically, at least through EPACT, the Energy Policy Act of 2005, energy was a bipartisan issue. By and large, people understood the need for reliability and security of supply, and it was only later when you began to see a shift, and it very much became a difference along different lines. What happened to Van Jones clearly, is unfortunate in that he was caught up in that political aspect. But the carbon tax is one. It's a very efficient way of allocating resources. It's like volatility necessary to provide the appropriate price signals and incentives as when investment is required. But I think we have to start from the perspective that in the energy sector, it had always been supported by government. There's a very interesting report that was done about 3 years ago by the Nuclear Research Institute, who was worried about energy subsidies. And it was called 60 Years of Subsidies, and it compared oil and gas and nuclear and renewables getting the larger share in the last several years, but it looked at a significant benefit that accrued to historically petroleum-based oil and natural gas. I think we just need to recognize that when we talk about subsidies or support, some are embedded in the tax code, and they don't require that you have to negotiate each year. Others, like the investment tax credit, are purposely given a time limited because it forces people back to the table to renegotiate. The direction, though, I think is clear, is the long-term renewables have to stand on their own merit, and you're seeing that happen. But I wouldn't disagree. Some of the policies, it's sort of a chicken and the egg, what comes first? You need the volume, you need the support of policies to provide that certainty. The example I would give you, we spoke briefly about this, is when I was working with the governor, this is when California put its Million Solar Roofs initiative, or what later became known as the California Solar Initiative. The being on inside working on the legislation and the concepts prior to even having that bill, there was debate within various folks in the administration. The one thing that I was focused on, having a business background, was the need for certainty over time about policies. You've heard that time and again, and it was one of the themes that we had. Certainty and clarity build confidence, and that's going to attract capital. So rather than do what Germany did, was to establish a very expensive feed-in tariff that was administratively determined, and I'll come back to that. California took a different route. It said, "We'll create incentives on $1 per watt," and even that was a point of debate. But dollars per watt, and we're going to start at $1, and then in 10 years, we're going to make sure that incentive is zero. This way, in the large enough money, it was $3.4 billion committed. It was enough money to allow the private sector to say, "I'm willing to invest capital in equipment, in manufacturing, in training, in hiring, and market development." And in fact, California was successful. Now, granted, everyone benefits from the activities globally on the product production and the cost coming down. But fundamentally, it was that clarity and certainty of people that would enable people to go out, borrow money, invest in the technology, and help move the market along. The China trade, you know, it's the trade issue there, clearly it was a problem, but it also got into tariffs and dumping, and no one can argue that the low-cost components benefit and create opportunity. But I think the long run here is you are seeing renewable energy being very competitive and competing at a cost less than coal, but certainly competitive in different functions than gas.
But California electricity prices are pretty high, and that's okay if you live in San Francisco, but if you're in Bakersfield, I think it's more of a problem.
It is. You raise a good point. California is an expensive place, and so relative to the current market cost, I think today there's about 13 or 14 states where rooftop solar is cost competitive with the retail rate. That's not the case in Texas, and you shouldn't be forced to do things that aren't necessarily uneconomic. What makes sense for Texas is to take full advantage of the wind resources that it has and build that grid capacity out. So different policies are appropriate for different sections of the country, I would say.
I have a comment and a question. A comment from a historical perspective. The Carter administration obviously had the solar panels on the White House. That was an interesting comment taken out by Reagan administration. And I just found it interesting that when Obama came on board and, you know, he was such a big proponent of the green energy, he didn't try to restore putting solar panels back in the White House. I think it would have been a nice touch to encourage people to see that renewable energy is given priority. But one of the things, looking at California, Texas, and everything, and the film concentrates primarily on domestic issues and trying to deliver power to houses, to malls, and to, you know, localized areas. But if you think of United States, a huge country, how do you integrate this to a national grid? And what sort of policy that would be sustainable, wouldn't compete with, you know, other interests, but actually have it integrated with a national grid for distribution? Because that brings into question, how do you store this energy? How do you make it more economical? How do you make it more efficient? And I know I understand I'm asking multiple questions, but I just wonder what your thoughts on it were.
I think we need the historian here. I don't think we want to tear up the Constitution, though. because in order to get everything uniform and directed from Washington, D.C., I think we'll probably find a way of muddling through, which is what we normally do. But if you send the right economic signals and make it, as you say, clear, transparent, and dependable, then I think our natural innovation will figure it out.
You raise a number of different issues. Some of the technical challenges of grid operation and how you dispatch resources and the types of resources that exist from base load to, say, ramping or flexible, like combined cycle natural gas or peaking units. Different resources serve different needs, and the grid has always been designed to accommodate changes in load. The real issue becomes what happens and how do I manage that cost effectively? What's the right amount of storage that is economic storage? Because there's only so much of it that's needed, otherwise these machines can clearly accommodate that. And that varies by grid, it varies by season, it varies by, you know, resource mix that you have. But to your question, the real growth opportunity is one that's global. We're seeing the same problems. I say we do business in China and in the Middle East and in South Africa, and we see the same challenges that too much variable resources bring quickly. Now beginning to appear in other countries. And the case in point I'll give is China. In fact, it was 2 days ago that China announced a 1 gigawatt pilot for concentrating solar thermal with thermal energy storage. And that's a technology that allows you to store bulk energy. I'm not talking about frequency regulation or seconds or behind the meter, but bulk energy in hundreds of megawatt hours on the grid to be used. Pumped hydro is another one. There's a lot of lithium ion batteries and that the costs are coming down, but the energy density isn't quite there on the traditional ones, solar thermal being an exception, but limited to those areas where you have lots of sun. But it is an interesting challenge that can be met technically, with new tech batteries. It can be met operationally by scheduling through market mechanisms that allow for resource sharing. So it's something that people are very much focused on, and they will solve that problem as they get to higher and higher levels of variable resource generation.
Hi. I saw on Wikipedia that the current laboratory solar panels can reach efficiency as high as 45 to 50%. Where do you see the efficiency rate go in 10 years? And I know wind energy is about 40% right now. Do you think it'll reach past wind energy in terms of efficiency?
I couldn't answer that question.
Yeah, I don't know.
So solar, well, there are two big modes of deploying solar energy. So one is photovoltaics. And this is what you see on solar panels on houses. And the other one is solar thermal, where you use solar energy to heat the fluid that's typically in utilities, and that fluid is then used to transfer this to turbine. And solar thermal is fundamentally limited by simply laws of thermodynamics to about 30% or more efficiency. And currently it's not, for practical reasons, it's not there, but the naturally set limit is 30%. Photovoltaics doesn't have such a limitation in principle, but it has limitations associated with materials, right? So sun just gives us some forms of radiations, and the materials we have currently are not matched with that spectrum, and so they absorb not all of that, but just a fraction of it that is matched with the properties of materials. And so I think that sort of a if we could practically reach 30% in a practical material on a large scale, this would already, in terms of material development, would be enough. And so the rest of it would be simply putting this in place on scale.
One more question.
So what are some good candidates in the innovation areas? Like, what are some good areas of innovation do you see that would come up in the next 10 years?
So well, this is a good question. I mean, that I don't have a complete answer to, but I think silicon-based solar cells are the category that is now dominant. The ones based on organic materials would be less environmentally damaging to produce. So the dye-sensitized solar cells are, and then. Strategies that use use light of a certain energy which is not suitable for conversion, but then convert that light, so up-convert it or down-convert it into light that is suitable, is also sort of a promising technology. So it is likely also that there'll be sort of hybrid solar cells which will combine several materials so that one material captures one portion of the spectrum and the other one captures the other, so that in sync they work together.
I have a question because it's not quite clear to me that in the video that we saw, it was they kept going on and on about how solar was cheaper than like the regular electricity that is provided. As a consumer, when you choose your plan, you see that the price for the renewable energy is more expensive than the other options available, and I also know that because the oil prices have crashed, it has affected like the amount of money that has been put in research for renewable energy, that's solar, wind, and all that. And I want to ask, you talked about reliability before, like if it happens that way again, maybe some other time, like we have the prices for the oil, they keep coming down like this because the market's going to be flooded by, you know, like the other countries that are going to release the oil soon. Is it always going to affect the business of the solar energy and like the prices, would they remain up that way, and then the other ones when they keep coming down? How's the economics gonna play?
First comment I'd make is there's very little correlation between the oil industry price, the price of oil and price of electricity. There's not a lot of generation that's based on oil. You can look at the transportation sector and think about that. So that's one. You also face considerable real risk, just normal weather risk or impacts of hurricanes. Hurricane Sandy, Hurricane Rita, they all represent impacts to existing gas infrastructure. Could be any. Could be a wind farm or a solar that's equally susceptible to that type of thing. So I would separate oil and transportation, what's happening in that sector, from the electricity. You're touching on the notion of retail choice, which you have here in Texas. California had a very failed example of how to implement choice at the retail level. People don't recognize there's a lot of that electricity bill that you have to pay are fixed charges or related to the grid or previous commitments and investments or long-term contracts. And so when you start adding a new resource, if that new resource is more expensive, it'll be called out that way. I think the notion is to give people a chance to choose if they believe that that's important and they're willing to pay more. And we see that in a number of markets where you can get a higher renewable mix and they track and manage that through renewable energy credits that say, okay, I generate and I retire a credit as an accounting system. But that's entirely up to you. If most utilities are working very hard at putting together plans that are in the interests of their ratepayers, that are approved by the regulators, that balance out those three things, you know, reliability, affordability, and doing it in an environmentally responsible manner.
And the, you probably noticed on your electricity bill that the bit that always seems to be going up is the center point bit, which is they're recovering the smart grid investments that they've made and also paying for the transmission lines from West Texas into Dallas. So we all pay that. And that was always the agreement, but at some point you find that the overall bill becomes much less supportable. The reason why we're in good shape is because natural gas is so cheap in Texas especially. So we're benefiting from that. If that were to change, and I'm not predicting it will. In fact, I probably won't. Then we'd start getting a double whammy of increased fixed charges and increased fuel charges.
Thank you very much for your questions. We're going to have some closing remarks.
Yes. Thank you very much. I'm Professor Radhakrishnan, and I'm the managing director of the UH Energy at the University of Houston. And I'd like to thank our panelists, Christian Winterstein, Joe Desmond, Dr. Milnick, okay, and Chris Ross. I'd like to thank our moderator, Terry Hallmark, for taking the time to really do a good job of getting all the questions laid out and then getting a good discussion going. Big thank to the Energy Coalition. These are students who really help in arranging for all of this. And there is a lot of energy ambassadors. These are all voluntary students who are selected. And they not only help with conducting some of these sessions, but they also do work at the UH Energy. We have an event coming up. Yeah. Our next event is the first Energy Symposium. We do that twice in the fall and twice in the spring. And this one will be on Clean Power Plan, continuation of this discussion. In a different angle. And once again, thank you very much. This is a real dedicated crowd. They had lots of good questions. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thanks for coming.